guaranteed for one of these insurance policies, even if you're retired or on Medicare. You can see any dentist you choose and never pay a deductible. Get coverage for less than a dollar a day and put less money where your mouth is. For your free information kit with all the details, call 1-800-719-5536. 1-800-719-5536.
It's perfect for getting me pumped up for the big game.
It's perfect for psyching me up to hit the gym.
It's perfect for hitting the road.
iHeartRadio introduces Perfect Four. The perfect tunes for the mood and moment. All at the touch of a finger. It's perfect for anything. 1,500 live radio stations. 15 million songs. And custom stations perfect for anytime. Best of all, it's free. Check it out and download the app at iHeartRadio.com.
I love cocktail party trivia like this. From 1939 to 1942, there was an undersea post office in the Bahamas. Fortunately, Radio Juniper always has a smart and interesting guest to help offset my lack of knowledge about things that actually matter. Tune in to Radio Juniper every Wednesday morning at 9 on News Talk 1090 WKBZ to learn some important stuff and some not-so-important stuff. Guess which ingredient I'm adding to the soup.
Fox News Radio, I'm Karen McHugh. Another Hurricane Sandy relief bill is working its way through the House.
This is a new bill because it's now a new Congress, and it can't carry over legislation from the previous Congress. Part of the reason that House Speaker John Boehner had to torpedo the last package was that Republicans didn't want to approve $60 billion in new spending without matching cuts elsewhere in the federal budget. Republicans are now adding dozens of amendments to do just that.
Fox News Radio's Chad Pergram. House GOP leaders created an uproar when they scrapped a similar package on New Year's Day. Award season continues to roll along. Tonight, it's the Golden Globes honoring the best in TV and movies. Among the nominees,
up for the best dramatic film, Argo, Django Unchained, Life of Pi, Lincoln, and Zero Dark Thirty.
Where was the last time you saw Bin Laden?
As for TV dramas, Breaking Bad, Boardwalk Empire, Downton Abbey, Homeland, and The Newsroom are all up against each other.
Fox Radio, Sabrina Sabah. Fox News, we report. You decide.
Here's the official News Talk 1090 WKBZ forecast. A winter weather advisory continues till 11 a.m. A light wintry mix of precipitation this morning will transition to a few snow showers this afternoon with a high of 32. Northwest winds 10 to 20. Scattered flurries and snow showers tonight, a low of 21. Northwest winds 20 to 30. Flurries and a few snow showers expected throughout the day tomorrow with a high of 26. And then a mix of sun and clouds on Tuesday at a high in the low 30s. News Talk 1090, the talk of Muskegon.
Well, your dadgum government, you sorry so-and-sos. You got your damn hands in every pocket of my clothes. Well, your dadgum.
The dadgum government. Hey, good morning, Muskegon. This is Ian Muskegon, and I'm Jim Riley, your host for this friendly little community conversation about politics, Michigan, politics, West Michigan, politics, Muskegon County, even national, and even occasional international politics and what's going on in the world today. And I'm here in Muskegon's Clear Channel Studios with the legendary and healthier with the new ticker parts, Oscar Osbo.
Ticker parts, yeah.
We've got the new parts. Parts is parts.
I'm the wizard.
The engineer is back.
The great and powerful Wizard of Oz.
There we go. We got Oscar back. And also helping us out, the old friend Tracy Lorenz, businessman, columnist, author, smart guy.
That's right.
Quipster, you know, there we go. So anyway, Tracy's with us. Also, at the 9 o'clock hour, we're going to have a call-in from a regular contributor and a guy who I have a tremendous amount of respect for also, and that's Jack Spencer from the Mackinac Center. And we will be talking with Jack a little more about prevailing wage. And the reason that this term, prevailing wage, is important is that it may cost us here in Muskegon anywhere between $2 million and $5 million, and perhaps even more, additional dollars if this jail is ever built in Muskegon County. And there's a way to stop this from costing us and still build the jail, but it would save us millions and millions of dollars. And we're going to talk about that with Jack Spencer. And that's at the 9 o'clock hour. And, you know, I get accused of forgetting to talk about the fact that we are a call-in show, and we have had some problems and maybe some little errors when people do call in, and we're looking in another direction. But
we need a huge light and a big siren go off.
We
or something.
Exactly.
That's what I have in my house.
You know, we get all geeked out over here. We're talking about important things, things that do matter.
They matter.
And so, please, we'd love to hear from you. The number is 231-830-3109. And in the event you do call and you don't get through, go to Ion Muskegon, and you can, there's the email address there, which is ionmuskegon@gmail.com. Send me a hate note, and let me know that you tried. And
I'm the hate note expert.
You've got me right here. Tracy, you've never gotten any hate notes, have you?
Yeah, I've gotten four.
Yeah, four. I can imagine when
got
you did your
last night.
Your flip flop column so many years ago.
Bastards. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay, anyway, so we do want to hear from you. 831-3109. And some housekeeping items. And I got to tell you, I just got an email from someone, and I'm not going to go into great detail, but there are forces and powers within the state of Michigan, both from the left and from the right, that do not want this conversation to happen. And that
is,
not so much our conversation here, I can assure you.
What am I doing here?
Plenty of people in Muskegon County probably don't want this conversation to happen. But tomorrow night, the newly reinvigorated Muskegon County Republican Party will be having their regular monthly meeting. It will be at 6 o'clock at Muskegon Community College. It's room 1202, and that's in the way I would view it. It's in the back building. Tracy, do you know if that's got a term for it?
The back building, I believe.
Okay.
It's the one where the floors aren't numbered upside down.
Yeah, the floors are, it's a very confusing. But anyway, it's room 1202, and but they're going to be having, in addition to their regular meeting, and by the way, this is an open forum. It's an open meeting for anyone in the county. But another expert, actually, this is the director of labor policy from the Mackinac Center, will be coming in, a gentleman named Vincent Vernuccio. I believe I'm pronouncing that correctly. And he will be also talking about prevailing wage. And as I said, we'll get into that in about a half hour. But surprisingly to me, the Muskegon County Republican Party is getting heat for having an open discussion on a policy that is purely one of choice in Muskegon County. And we're getting complaints and pressure from Republicans, state-level Republicans.
What?
We don't want to have this conversation because it might be embarrassing to us. And
never stopped me.
Well, no, it didn't stop you. It's not going to stop us here at Ion Muskegon either.
That's right.
Certainly, the unions and the special interests and those people who are greedily benefiting from profit from procedures and policies that enrich them on the backs of all of the citizens and the businesses in our county. They don't want us talking about it. But the fact that we have elected Republicans, the state-level Republicans, and others who say don't talk about it because it might be embarrassing, it might upset the unions, maybe that's a real hint as to what the problem here is in one of the worst states in terms of economic performance in the United States of America. So, anyway, if you want to see what unions, Democrats, and Republican leaders don't want you to see or learn about, you can have an opportunity to do this tomorrow night, 6 o'clock, Muskegon Community College. Everyone is invited. We've got a whole bunch of new, very energetic, enthusiastic people in the Muskegon County Republican Party, and they sent me this piece to let you know about it. So,
will there be donuts?
You know, the Republican Party in Muskegon County is kind of broke. unlike the Democrat Party, which is heavily supported by union members because of the laws that require to be
I
in
saw
unions.
A list of what they're going to have at the second inauguration party,
yeah,
which doesn't really seem necessary. I mean, I can see the first one, the second one, it's kind of a redundant.
More stars.
Stars, more champagne.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, that doesn't happen here in the Muskegon County Republican Party because we do not have a way to forcefully extract money from folks. But at some point, Maybe we will.
Maybe snacks.
We'll build things up.
Maybe
and,
a vegetable tray.
We're in a Democrat county, folks. You know, it's that's the way it is. But anyway, so that issue will be out tomorrow night, and we'll also talk about it in just a few minutes.
No, Kelly Clarkson coming to that party.
Yeah, we've got some attractive Republican women here. Certainly, I would.
Can they sing?
I would. One would hope not. Okay. Hey, but there's MLive, I think, very graciously put on there on the Muskegon site the invitation and the information about this Muskegon County Republican meeting, Republican Party meeting. And what I found interesting were a couple of comments, and I'll just read this to you. Quote, as a former member of the Muskegon County Republican Executive Committee, and I don't know who this was, I'm glad to see them being active and reaching out publicly to address the pertinent issues of the day. I was not a popular member of the committee due to my true conservatism in economic and social issues. Sounds like the committee's on the right track right now. And then someone else, who I'm not familiar with either, said, please join us Monday night. You will be welcome now. And that's the big difference. This group is interested in fiscal conservatism. We are interested in accountable government. We don't have a problem having conversations with people who we disagree on about issues that might bring a little emotion to the table. And I do know that we would not have in this state this right to work law, this freedom to work law, if it wasn't for brave people who stood tall against the thuggery, and truly there is thuggery out
it's
there.
It's thuggery. I've experienced
that,
it.
That some people use and get away with. And so good for this little group. Now, I'll mention the thuggery here just as an item, which I didn't realize. I might have heard this years ago. But, Tracy, are you familiar with the Hobbs Act?
Was that instituted by Calvin Coolidge?
No, it's 1946.
The Calvin and Hobbes reference.
This is
that no one got.
No, I missed that. Well, I don't read Calvin and Hobbes any longer. Although I used to.
No one does.
No, get this.
Hobbes got hit by
a car.
The Hobbes
Act of 1946. Quote, labor groups are immune from prosecution under the Hobbs Act provision that criminalized extortion and robbery using the threat or fear of force. So, in other words, the Hobbs Act criminalized extortion and robbery using the threat of fear of force. But labor groups are exempt from that.
Huh.
And right now, a Senator Mike Lee, this is a U.S. senator at Utah, is attempting to close that that loophole. He's not succeeding. So, again, we want to talk about the issues, and if it upsets people, that's I guess, to be expected.
Just duck.
Well, I think there's another. I'd like just another couple of points I'd like to talk about in terms of relative to this. We live in Muskegon County, which is right next door to Ottawa County, and I've said time and again that our biggest competition, of course, isn't Texas or Florida or India or any other place. It's Ottawa County, and we most clearly by every measure in terms of overspending and overemploying and making it onerous for companies to come into our community, we have succeeded in keeping them out of our community and pushing them into the surrounding communities. And in many cases, the response, certainly by me and others, has been, hey, let's throw the bums out. Well, unfortunately, because of gerrymandering, redistricting, and the like, it's very rare that you see incumbents thrown out. Now, we did this past year, we had three county commissioners, the three new county commissioners, five actually, are gone from the old board. But as a general rule, we don't throw out the bums nationally or locally. Well, Milton Friedman, the Nobel Prize-winning economist, an extraordinarily brilliant guy, has had all sorts of wonderful quotes. I think I used one last week. But he's got another one that I think is really important. And it says, quote, we don't need to throw the bums out. It's nice to elect the right people, but that's not the way you solve things. The way you solve things is by making it politically profitable for the wrong people to do the right things. Hmm. And the point being is you've got to work with what you got.
That's exactly right.
And if we have, if we are fiscal conservatives and we want our elected officials, be they Republican or Democrat, to do the right thing, not just pander to the special interests, to pass laws that will give the special interests, those insiders, those crony capitalists, extra frankly, extra money on the backs of, really, let's face it, it's primarily on the backs of the poor, because who, when you have a county that excludes and makes it well known that we don't like employers, who gets hit first? Of course, it's employees. So in other words, it's the unemployed, the folks who live here who can't get work, the folks who live here who have to suffer through bad roads or bad policing, or, you know, not bad policing, but reduced the police protection and other things. Those are the ones who get who pay the penalty, and this is a great opportunity for us to talk about how we can make those people who are elected do the right things. We don't care about their motivation; we just want them to do the right thing. And Roger Miller probably would like that if he wasn't dead, but we're not dead. We're going to take a break, and we'll be right back after this.
We just smell like it.
The truth about too good to be true car insurance is that it is. That's why Esurance created the Coverage Counselor tool. It helps you choose the right coverage for you at a great price. Esurance, insurance for the modern world. Now back by Allstate. Click or call.
Coverage Counselor highlights options to consider in choosing coverage, not available in all states.
America had just gone to war when Felipe Adams volunteered.
I knew what I was signing up for. I knew the consequences. I took a bullet to the side and left me paralyzed.
For Armando de la Rosa, the Navy was a chance to serve and see the world.
I got medically discharged in 2001.
Armando and Felipe were brought together by a unique organization that serves our paralyzed veterans.
If there was no PVA, it'd be a lot of confusion. Our training is to better the veteran. We help out with the auto grant, the special housing adaptation grant, education, prosthetics. Our main focus is spinal cord injury and disease, but we see anybody.
First thing he had asked me before he even asked my name was I being taken care of as a veteran? And I thought that was pretty good.
Changing lives, building futures. That's Paralyzed Veterans of America. To learn more, visit PVA.org.
Car number 7 is pulling into the pit.
What's my winning diabetes plan?
Start taking action now for diabetes.
Medication.
Got him. And my insulin supplies.
Exercise.
Most days.
Blood sugar level?
On target.
Diet?
Eating healthy.
A1C? Under control.
Managing diabetes, including controlling blood sugar, is a team effort that requires a plan that's right for you. For more information, visit StandForDiabetes.org.
A public service of TCOYD made possible with support from Sanofi Aventis, U.S.
24,000 children die every day from preventable causes. My name is Neo, and I believe that number should be zero. Believe in zero.
Join the effort. Visit unicefusa.org.
The Talk of Muskegon. News Talk 1090, WKBZ.
Well, you dadgum government, you sorry so-and-sos. You got your damn hands in every pocket of my clothes.
And those hands are in every pocket of all of your clothes, even those clothes you're not wearing here in Michigan. This is
that's not a pocket.
Well, you know, it's funny. I was doing my show prep, and the state of Michigan, I don't know if you've started to do your taxes, but a lot of people have. And there have been a lot of differences in the state taxes this year. And I don't want to get into too deep into it. We'll really lose the audience here. But something that shocked me. Now, the state income tax is reduced from 4.35% to 4.25%. That's good. We want to reduce the size of state government. We want to reduce the taxes to those folks who live here so that we can attract more people to come here. Florida has no state tax. They're booming. We have a state tax. We're not. But one thing I found interesting, most of us have what's called a homestead property tax credit. So, in other words, if you are paying... if you're living in your home and you're paying property taxes, you've got a tax credit of $1,200, which I think it was actually bigger than that in the past. But anyway, but if your home has a taxable value of greater than $135,000, which isn't a tremendously expensive home in most parts of the state, that a cap does not apply any longer. So you
really?
Yeah.
That doesn't really affect Muskegon, though, unless you're on the lake.
Only the evil rich, only the people that we'd like to move to Ottawa County.
I live in Ottawa County.
I found that, yeah, well, that's my point. And that's my point. But the good news is, finally, for the first time, those people who are on the government dole, those be teachers and government employees, will be paying taxes on their, state taxes on their income. And don't you think that's just horribly unfair that for criminal. Decades. The rest of us had to pay taxes on our income, but teachers, police, state, county, city employees did not.
Which is the majority of the working people in Michigan, or
yes,
a good chunk of it anyway.
Yes, and of course they were screaming bloody, bloody murder over that. You know, over the fact that they would have to pay their fair share. I guess fair share matters a lot to those, as long as it doesn't include themselves. Hey, I want to talk a little bit, just briefly, about what's going on in New York this past week. And I don't know if it's possible. I suspect it's not. If it's possible to get rid of Obamacare. But we're now seeing not just the cost of Obamacare. We're hearing all over the place that various insurance companies and
my insurance went up due to Obamacare. Was the exact reason they gave, went up from $150 a month to $650 a month. Whoa. With a $4,000 deductible.
And you were assured that it was going to go down.
Going to go down.
That was, I know that was part of the deal.
Or go up basically the price of a new Mercedes. $500 a month. You can get a pretty nice car for $500 a month. Well, and that's just money Volt. You're just giving away. And get a Volt.
Yeah. Well,
then get a second one, a Revolt.
And that is the problem. But there's another side of it. The cost is one side of the issue. The other side of it is the quality of care that you receive. And we know that in New York City, for instance, which is run by Mayor Bloomberg, who is so focused on big gulp drinks, their maximum size of the drinks that you can buy. Which is kind of like the gun control. You know, he says you can't buy, I don't know, about 32 ounce, but you could buy 2 16 ounces, or you could buy 10 16 ounces if you're so inclined. Same thing with the gun clip. For some reason, those nannies on the left figure that if you can't buy a gun clip for 12 bullets, then you won't buy two for 10 or 10 for 10 bullets. But anyway, the mayor of New York has a weekly radio show that he goes on, and he's talking about his new plan to reduce the amount of painkillers that are given to people who come into the city-run hospitals. Apparently, in New York, they have city-controlled hospitals. Now, listen to this. This is a quote from Mayor Bloomberg of New York City about his new plan to reduce the amount of painkillers offered to people who come in to help reduce pain. Quote, the city hospitals we control, so we're going to do it, and we're urging all of the hospitals to do it. Voluntary guidelines. Somebody wrote, then maybe there won't be enough painkillers for the poor who use the emergency rooms as their primary care doctor, the mayor said on his weekly radio show. Number one, there's no evidence of that, says the mayor, which, of course, there's no evidence because his plan hasn't been put into place yet.
Yeah.
But number
plus,
two,
when's the last time that guy was in an emergency room? All you got to do is walk in and you can see.
Exactly. Right. Well, but get this. Number two, supposing it really is true, so you don't get enough painkillers, so you did have to suffer a little bit. The other side of the coin is people are dying and blah, blah, blah. In other words, who cares? So you don't have enough painkiller. That is the nanny state. That is the mindset of the people who are running our health care now. Remember, this isn't something coming down the pike.
Well, it also affects the economy right, because if you don't get the extra painkillers, you can't sell them outside the hospital to make a little extra money.
Well, you know what? That is one of the arguments that is used, that perhaps that physicians are over-medicating, and that's an entirely different issue. If the physicians are over-medicating, then fix that. But just to do an across-the-board, which is what government does all the time.
Do you have any names of those over medicating physician?
Well, I don't know. I know I've had plenty when I've gone in for my various maladies. Anyway, that's the future, folks. It's not just the future; it's here. This is Britain, the country that we are most like in the rest of the world, with perhaps the exception of our suburb, Canada.
Sense of our teeth and our
here's a headline: 60,000 patients put on death pathway without being told. But the Minister of Health says the controversial end of life plan is fantastic. The pathway involves sick being sedated and usually denied nutritional and fluids. Families are kept in the dark as when doctors withdraw life saving treatments. This is for you, Oscar. If that little extra ticker part you got doesn't work well and you're in Britain, get a quick flight home.
because
hopefully real quick before Obamacare kicks in, because the death panels, somebody is going to decide who should get the additional painkillers, who should get the additional nutritional fluids and the like in England. That's government. And by the way, that health care, free.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're inclined to go for free, there is a great option out there. Here's another report.
Unless you get sick.
Yeah, right, death.
Well, it's free, though. Come on now. Let's not get care. Free is the ultimate goal for almost everything for a certain number of people in this country and in the world. Here's an interesting report. This is, I don't know if you've seen this, but Americans die younger, contract more STDs than any other high-income country worldwide. I guess the top...
We're number one.
20. No, we're actually one of the bottom. We're one off the bottom. And now, here's to me the quote, though. This is one of the people who's behind this the study, I believe. But says, quote, "Research is important, but we should not wait for more data before taking action because we already know what to do. If we fail to act, the disadvantage will continue to worsen, and our children will face shorter lives and greater rates of illnesses than their peers in other rich nations." Now, let's get back to that. Research is important, but we should not wait for more data before taking action. No. And of course, taking action is to give this person billions of dollars to spend on whatever their belief is. It's not necessary to get more data.
Is that kind of like if we can't tell you what's in it until you sign it?
Pretty freaking much, yes, yeah. This is your government, folks. They will do... You know the thing that really shocks me, and I am shocked almost every time I get on the internet, is that these people are in massively high-level jobs, and they are compensated to the freaking max.
The Peter Principle.
Talk about compensated to the max. I don't know if you've heard about this, but there was a gentleman in Detroit, Michigan, who was making, I don't know, $120,000, $130,000 a year. But he that wasn't enough. He had a full-time job. He was involved in sewer or something along those lines. And so he got another job at the same time in Flint. He was making, between the two jobs, he was a full-time in Flint employee, full-time Detroit employee, Detroit Water and Sewer Management, $273,000 between the two jobs.
He was the only person employed full-time.
Yeah,
in both
that's
cities.
Not the case. So here's the headline. Moonlighting security official Barnett Jones will keep his job at the Detroit Water Department after resigning. Quote, "Barnett Jones is doing a fine job for us at the Detroit Water and Sewer District. Jones came with extensive experience," blah, 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 blah. So in other words, after being found of having two full-time jobs, now he did get fired from, or he did resign, actually. He didn't get fired from the Flint job. But the people in Detroit have no problem with the fact that this guy was pulling down another job, didn't tell anybody.
Probably a hero. It says security. He was, so he didn't like actually work in the sewer like Ralph Cramden. He was a
security guy. Wasn't Ralph.
No, wait. That was Ralph Cramden was a bus driver. It was Ed Norton.
Norton was in the sewer. I suspect this guy. By the way, the two jobs.
Is that the namesake for Norton Shores was? Just coincidentally?
Yes. That's very possible.
Heavyweight champion and sewer worker.
Maybe we had to change the name of Norton Shores into something else.
Cramden Shores.
Anyway, this gentleman, his two jobs were 70 miles apart, and nobody caught it. This, by the way, I think was caught by a reporter. Nobody caught it at either place. And I promise you, in Detroit, as we're hearing all the time, and in Flint, they're going to tell you, we're out of money. We've cut to the bone. There's no place to cut. We are really doing a great job for you. That's your government at work, folks. We're going to take a break, and we'll come back. We'll talk about the term Republicans and Democrats alike don't want you to know about prevailing wage.
Yikes.
Love me sometime.
What's a lever action? What's a pump? What's an automatic? What's a bolt action? Hi, folks. I'm Tom Gresham, and I invite you to join me as we answer these and other questions on Gun Talk. Gun Talk is the only show out there about gun rights, collecting, personal defense, sport, and recreational shooting. And, of course, we never forget about safety on Gun Talk.
It's Gun Talk, Sunday afternoons at 3 on News Talk 1090 WKBZ, the talk of Muskegon.
I don't want a prostate exam any more than you do. I don't want to pay taxes either, but I do. There are just some things you can't escape. Listen, there are more than 2 million American men living with prostate cancer right now. and every 18 minutes, one of those men dies. Early detection and treatment of prostate cancer provides a 5-year survival rate greater than 97%. So spend a few seconds doing what you gotta do, so you have the rest of your life to do what you wanna do. Go to PCF.org to learn more and join the fight. Brought to you by the Prostate Cancer Foundation.
The Talk of Muskegon is News Talk 1090, WKBC Muskegon, and heard 24 hours a day on WOOD HD2 Muskegon.
You're smart enough to know when a deal seems too good to be true, like a no-sweat workout plan or a $5 prime rib buffet. But when you're shopping for car insurance, it's surprisingly easy to get duped into crummy coverage. That's why Esurance created the Coverage Counselor, an online tool to help you choose the right coverage for you at a great price. Too good to be true? Nope. Just insurance for the modern world. Esurance. Now backed by Allstate. Click or call.
Coverage Counselor highlights options to consider in choosing coverage. Not available in all states.
I knew I was stuck at this kid's house for the night. I decided to just go to sleep and get the night over with. But those guys came into the bedroom and got into a massive pillow fight. Let me tell you, it's not easy falling asleep when a sweaty little kid falls on you every 5 seconds. Even after the lights went out, Raleigh and his friends stayed up. A bunch of them snuck up on me to try and pull the hand in a bowl of warm water trick. Well, that was enough for me. I went downstairs to sleep in the basement even though it was pitch black. I left my sleeping bag upstairs and that was a mistake. Because it was freezing. I think it was probably the longest night of my life. When the sun came up this morning, I found out the reason it was so cold. I was sleeping right by the sliding glass door, and some fool had gone and left it open overnight. That really stunk, because if I knew there was a way to escape last night, I definitely would have taken it. To read more about the sleepover, check out Diary of a Wimpy Kid, The Last Straw by Jeff Kinney. Explore new worlds and check out more cool books at your local library, and visit read.gov. Brought to you by the Library of Congress and the Ad Council.
Car number 7 is pulling into the pit.
Team, I want peak performance. Let's go over my diabetes checklist.
Start taking action now for diabetes.
Medication.
Got them. And my insulin supplies.
Exercise.
Check at least 30 minutes most days.
Blood sugar level?
On target.
Diet?
Eating healthy.
And your A1C is under control.
Keeping your blood pressure and your cholesterol in the zone is also important.
Check. How am I doing?
Your numbers are looking good. You're good to go.
Thanks, team.
Whoa, look at number 7, racing out of the pit.
Managing diabetes, including controlling blood sugar, is a team effort. Keeping your body at its peak performance requires a plan that's right for you. Take the wheel and start taking action now for diabetes. For more information, visit standfordiabetes.org. That's standfordiabetes.org.
A public service of TCOYD made possible with support from Santa Fe Aventis, U.S.
America had just gone to war when Felipe Adams volunteered.
I took a bullet to the side and left me paralyzed.
For Armando De La Rosa, the Navy was a chance to serve and see the world.
I got medically discharged in 2001.
For injured veterans like Felipe Adams, there are veterans like Armando De La Rosa ready to help.
Our training is to better the veteran.
Paralyzed Veterans of America, changing lives, building futures. Visit PVA.org.
Here's the official News Talk 1090 WKBZ forecast. A winter weather advisory continues till 11 a.m. A light wintry mix of precipitation this morning will transition to a few snow showers this afternoon with a high of 32. Northwest winds 10 to 20. Scattered flurries and snow showers tonight, a low of 21. Northwest winds 20 to 30. Flurries and a few snow showers expected throughout the day tomorrow with a high of 26. And then a mix of sun and clouds on Tuesday at a high in the low 30s. News Talk 1090, the talk of Muskegon.
This is Mike McCready, Pearl Jam's lead guitarist. For the last 24 years, I've been living with Crohn's disease, a chronic and often painful digestive disease. Luckily, I have my disease under control. But so many of the 1.4 million Americans living with Crohn's and a similar disease called ulcerative colitis live day to day not knowing when their disease will strike next. You can help by joining one of the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation's 130 Take Steps walks. Sign up today at cctakesteps.org. Take a step, register today.
Talk 1090 is the talk of Muskegon.
Well, you're dead gum government, you sorry so-and-sos. You got your damn hands in every pocket of my clothes.
Who? The dadgum government's got its hands in every pocket of our clothes, and we just found a new pocket with the same old familiar hands. Thankfully, we've got the Mackinac Center to help us out, and one of my favorite guys in the whole state anyway, Jack Spencer. Good morning, Jack.
Good morning.
Thanks for being here. And again, thank you for those of you who've been listening and over time. You've heard Jack talk about a variety of issues, but one that he has been very passionate about has been this union scam to rip off the poorest of the poor in our state on this home health care forced unionization and home health care and home, what's the other word?
Home caregiver?
Yeah, the home care, yeah. Anyway, so, and you won that. And you won that because you never gave up. And I say that the number one person out there to get this done was you and certainly some of the brave, mostly Republicans who pushed that issue. But we're going to talk about something different. And this is a very critically important issue for people listening here in Muskegon County. And I suspect it's important in any other county that has this onerous scam created purely to enrich insiders with political connections. At the cost, the serious cost of the taxpayers, the businesses, and the citizens in a county, and that is something called prevailing wage. And Jack, maybe you want to explain what prevailing wage is, and we'll take it from there.
Well, basically, prevailing wage is another leftover from a time period when there was just so much money in government that the unions were allowed to just continually have built-in perks and built-in advantages. And, of course, it was more easily masked that the taxpayers were getting bilked because everything was going so comparatively well with the United States dominating world economics and everything that you could make the argument that the more everybody made, the more the economy just tumbled forward, and it was just it was never something that I think taxpayers would have liked if they'd been fully aware of it, and many of them actually were anyhow.
But let's tell them what it is.
Basically, what it is that you have a government project, and the project when you hire the people are going to build something.
The contractors.
The contractors, et cetera. They have to pay the workers a prevailing wage. And the prevailing wage is an average of the union wage in a particular region.
And it's also a little beyond that, too, because it includes union benefits.
Right.
And also the way certain counties, and I think Muskegon's is similar, it does require, if not that it requires union labor, it requires, the definition is such that it, as a matter of practicality, it does require union hiring.
Yeah, if you're a private contractor and you have your way of figuring how you're going to do the project, and you put in your bid, you're trying to get the low bid possible to do the project. If it's got a prevailing wage on it, you have to average that in, and you probably can't pay it. It just chases away a lot of cheaper private contractors from doing these projects.
This is Tracy Lorenz.
That's okay. Introducing you there.
But I am one of those contractors who own a construction company, and it's almost impossible to figure out what the prevailing wage is or what you have to figure for the people that you have to pay. And they check that stuff pretty closely, and it's a big risk if you get it wrong. So it does tend to chase away the non-union contractors.
The ones that end up working on these big projects usually are little parts of the projects at most, aren't they?
Right.
Yeah. And basically what it does is it just sets the cost up so much that you're basically almost you know, you're limiting who can even bid on a contract, and that's going to be done by union labor.
Well, we just bid on a job out at the Muskegon Winter Sports Complex, putting a new roof on the building, which is a county-owned building that we lease or rent or something from them. Anyway, instead of, you would normally figure maybe $8 to $10 an hour for a roofer, and you had to, with prevailing wage, it was, I think, $32.40 plus benefits. So it's a pretty big chunk that someone's paying somewhere down the line.
And let me just add, as a point of clarification, this term prevailing wage, which in its simplest form, I guess, is just requires who's ever going to bid to use union wages, union benefits, and that type of thing. This is not a national law. It is not a federal law when it comes to, or a state law when it comes to county spending. It does cover monies that are given from the federal government, and it does cover monies that are given from the state government. But at the county level, and this is why it's important now, because the county is talking about building a jail anywhere from $30 to $50 or $60 million, and Muskegon County commissioners have imposed this rule on the county, essentially on themselves, to force anybody to bid on this to be under prevailing wage. And how does that matter to us here in Muskegon County? Well, if you're going to spend, let's just say, $40 million, and Jack, you wrote an excellent article in the Muskegon Capital, or the Michigan Capital Confidential, where you said that the cost is up 10, maybe up to 20%.
Well, and you're trying to make these estimates, and actually, I think the story lowballed it because, first of all, it's a project, as you mentioned there. There's still this wide gap as to how much it's going to cost and so on to try to figure it out. So you tend to lowball how much more it's going to make things cost. A lot of studies have been done, putting it at, 10 to 14% increases when they're done with prevailing wage. Mackinac Center's done its own study. There have been other ones nationally, and it's pretty much, that range, 10 to 14 to 15% more. You made a very important point there, Jim, though, that it is the locals who make the decision as to whether they have prevailing wage or not. If the monies aren't coming from the state and or the monies aren't coming from the federal government, they have very little choice in those areas when the funding's actually coming from elsewhere. But what's tricky is you call and you ask, okay, how come you're doing this? And there's quite often the answer you'll get back is, well, we have to do, what the state prevailing wage is. And that's misleading because it's the locals who pass that rule. To go, what they're talking about when they say that is we're going to use the state formula, but it still is up to local government to decide whether they do that or not when they're raising their own money.
And
which is what Muskegon's doing.
Let me just interrupt here for a sec, though, because that is what we're getting time and again, sadly, from the elected officials and some of the supervisory folks here in Muskegon County. They will give us that half truth, that sophistry, that will send you off in the wrong direction, even though we know the full story. And let me just quote from the article that you had written, which, by the way, is in you can find it in the Michigan Capital Confidential. You can Google Mackinac Center. It's also on Ion Muskegon and on MuskegonPundit.com. But, quote, on December 13th, Muskegon County Administrator Bonnie Hammersley told Michigan Capital Confidential that she'd prefer the prevailing wage ordinances not apply to the jail project. Quote, my understanding is that if we don't have federal dollars in it, we don't need to use prevailing wage. We won't use it unless we have to because it's an administrative burden. It adds to the cost. So clearly, the county is not in the dark about this, and we have nine newly sworn in county commissioners who could easily pick up on this and who ought to pick up on this. And I would just like to jump over to Tracy, because even though Jack is saying that maybe the increase is 10 to 15% and it's probably higher than that. But that's of the entire project, much of which are you know, materials and right. things that aren't covered by
yeah,
this.
But if it's a labor-intensive project, it's going to be a lot higher.
Yeah.
Than
well, what did you just say? From $8 to $10 to 30 plus benefits.
Right. Yeah, it's a big chunk. Plus like, was it Bonnie mentioned?
Bonnie Hammersley.
The administration of a prevailing wage job is, that's money on top of that, because you have to show every employee what they were paid and what they used to be paid, and you know they
oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, you can't just, they don't just take your word for it.
So you have to file any number of paperwork.
You've got to show them that you actually paid these people that much money.
Now, you know,
one of the problems I have at the sports complex, and this may sound, I'm not getting around, but most of the work that's done out there is done by prisoners.
That's interesting.
Yeah, they bring them out there in a bus, and they prisoners do most of the labor out there for the ice rinks and the luge track and whatever else is done by prisoners. So they said, well, you can use the prisoners when you're scraping off the old roof and stuff. They can load up the dumpsters, and no one could answer me. Do I have to pay the prisoners prevailing wage? Do those fall under my
jurisdiction? And nobody could answer that.
Nobody could tell me so I had to bump my bid up a little bit because I didn't want to have someone come back later and go, oh yeah, you got to pay these prisoners $32 an hour.
Well, this is government interference, and it's self-imposed. It is our county commissioners. Remember, there are only 9 people in the county, actually only 5, if you could get 5 of them to vote one way or the other, that are actually enforcing this, imposing this on the taxpayers and the businesses in Muskegon County. Jack, you had written extensively about this, and we are one of the few counties in the state that actually does this self-imposition of higher expenditures. Is that correct?
Yes, one of only a handful out of the 83 states. It's just, you can count them on one hand. And
I bet you Detroit and or Wayne County and Genesee County are on that same hand.
Yeah, it's sort of the usual suspects.
Yeah, look at a failed county. Look at a failed prospect. Or a failed concept, and if Muskegon's got it, and we can see who else is utilizing the same ridiculous laws.
Well, and it's going the other direction too, Jim. We've been seeing in the last year Bay City getting rid of theirs. We've seen Eaton County get rid of their prevailing wage. So even though there's only a handful in the state, it's still even moving further and further away from it.
You know, this to me is just as disgusting as it gets, because at the same time that we're being told that the county is, you know, really cut back, they're to the bone, that the services are cut back, that in fact our, even though we, our county tax is double what it is in Ottawa County, even though that our unfunded pension and retirement for the county employees is in the hundreds, over $100 million. They're telling us that we're money's tight, we've got to do the right thing, and yet they're going to stick with their cronies, with their buddies who've greased their palms in a variety of ways to keep this scam going, so that the taxpayers of the county are going to pay millions and millions of additional dollars. And let me give you a little an anecdote. A few years ago, the Republican Party volunteers were standing in front of Walmart, and they were ringing the bell for the Salvation Army. And, of course, we all know that unions, and Democrats in particular, have been really going after Walmart because it's a non-union store and how horrible Walmart is. Well, when it comes to spending your own money, it seems that Democrats tend to be a little more, let's say, interested than when it comes to spending other people's money. And as we're ringing the bell, trying to get some money for the Salvation Army, up walks up, who didn't catch who we were because we had kind of Santa hats and all, the chairman of the Muskegon County the Board of Commissioners and a very notable Democrat, Ken Mahoney, who's just reelected. And Ken saw us and took a stop. He took a start. He said, oh, my gosh, these Republicans are going to see me coming into Walmart. And, of course, he was outed at that point, and he said hi and went in. Well, this is a gentleman that I'm sure, when he's hanging with his Democrat cronies, is more than happy to demonize those folks at Walmart, because his pocket matters, his own money. He's no different than a Republican in that respect, and no different than any other citizen. But when it's somebody else's money, and he can shovel it to the insiders who've created this scam by their own law, and then they'll go out and they'll tell people, oh, we had to abide by these policies, you know, we had these policies in place. They could change that next Tuesday if they wanted to.
Now, Jack, do you know if with prevailing wage they can be selective by bid category? Like, can you say it has to be union plumbers and union electricians, but they can be non-union general laborers, roofers, drywallers, whatever, painters?
I'm not sure how they do that.
In Muskegon County, it does not break it down. You can go right on the county, right on Muskegon. We've got a link to the exact verbiage, which was put in about 12 years ago. And they put it in such a manner so it didn't have to be re-approved. So the current Board of Commissioners can say, oh, I didn't vote for that. Well, of course they voted for it by not bringing it up. But it does cover everything. And you wouldn't believe, I went through and looked at the paperwork, as you just said, Tracy, the requirements and proof of the benefits and all sorts of stuff. It is an absolute nightmare, unless you're a big insider union shop where that's what everybody does.
Well, let's talk about complicated. I mean, the story that I wrote there that you quoted from, your own county administrator there, the day that I did that, she seemed to think they still had the option not to use prevailing wage. And it was the next day that she had, and I was glad, you know, she was very nice to make sure they got back with me, but she had someone else who was more familiar with the project call me back and basically explain, yeah, we do have to do prevailing wage.
And isn't that, I mean, think about this. You're talking about, Muskegon County doesn't have enormous projects very often. This is a very, very important big issue. One of the things that's in your article that frankly stunned me, and what you just told me sort of stuns me, that the county administrator wouldn't even be aware of it. But the chief financial person, supervisor at the county, who's a gentleman named Heath Kaplan, says, quote, that's when you had asked, apparently, if the ordinance would add $2 million or more to the project. He, quote, says, that seems somewhat high to me. However, he said he wasn't certain of a better estimate. So, in other words, not only were they unaware of it, and they continue probably to not let people know much about it, but they haven't even bothered to sit down and say, okay, look, let's find out what would it cost us to have prevailing wage for a particular project, and what would it cost us not to? I mean, at least as a general rule of thumb.
It would not be that difficult to do. You just call the separate contractors, and you know, we put together estimates all the time for budgets, and just, you know, call a union electrician, and call a non-union, a union whoever in a non-union, and just compare them.
Let's face it. This is for the insiders. This is for those folks, those cronies who have created. You know, there's all this talk on the left about greed. Let me tell you, folks, this angers the heck out of me. This is pure greed. This is pure insider trading. This is, and we've got leaders who we pay a significant amount of money. Let me tell you, County Administrator Hammersley makes a lot of money for somebody here in Muskegon County. And so does Heath Kaplan, who is the finance director. That they didn't even know this? I mean, seriously, that's stunning.
Well, I think it gets back to your point, and so much of all of this that's been coming out of the woodwork in the past, let's say, half a decade in particular, even though it's been around for decades, it's really about other people's money.
Yeah.
Now, if you were going to do this and it was your money, the first thing you check is how much extra it was going to cost.
Right.
Yeah, you would know to the penny.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, they, you know, your article again. The title of the article is "County Prevailing Wage Law Could Add Millions to Taxpayer Costs." We got a break coming up, and I'd like you to hang on if you could, because you had suggested that maybe there's some good news coming down the pike about this onerous scam against the good folks of Muskegon County, one that could be fixed in literally 30 seconds with a quick vote. So we'll be back after the break.
The truth about too good to be true car insurance is that it is. That's why Esurance created the Coverage Counselor tool. It helps you choose the right coverage for you at a great price. Esurance, insurance for the modern world. Now backed by Allstate. Click or call.
Coverage Counselor highlights options to consider in choosing coverage not available in all states.
The Talkin' Muskegon program can now be heard live every morning, Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. to 9 a.m. here on News Talk 1090. This is John Van White.
And Brian Worsham. We will focus on community events, news, weather, and sports. We'll also bring you traffic updates, weekly segments like the movies with Ron Van Timmeren, the Biker Report, and Lumberjacks. This is Talkin' Muskegon right here, 8 to 9 a.m. on the Talk of Muskegon, News Talk 1090.
I can solve difficult problems for a Fortune 500 company.
I can run a successful business.
I can manage your home improvements.
I can publicize your message.
I can motivate your audience.
I can put my military experience to work for your company.
I can teach your children.
I can boost your bottom line.
I can add value to your workplace.
I could be a loyal and productive employee.
But I can't put my skills to work for your organization
if I'm not given the opportunity.
If you don't recognize my talents and ability.
If you don't hire me.
If you don't have an open mind and a workplace that's open to everyone.
If you don't realize that America works best when everybody works.
What can you do?
What can you do?
What can you do?
You can remember that it works.
It's what people can do.
It's what people can do that matters.
Nearly 50 million Americans have disabilities. Capitalize on their talents with employment practices that benefit everyone. Learn more at whatcanyoudocampaign.org.
In the streets below, traffic had stopped. Pedestrians were lying on sidewalks and curled up in doorways. There was no sign of violence, no wrecks, nothing like that. It was as if the people in New York had simply decided to stop whatever they were doing and pass out. Ice coated my stomach. The invasion has started. To find out what happens next, read Percy Jackson and the Olympians by Rick Reardon. Explore new worlds and check out more cool books at your local library. And visit read.gov. Brought to you by the Library of Congress and the Ad Council.
They don't have to die, but they do. 24,000 children every day. My name is Orlando Bloom, and I believe that that number should be zero. Believe in zero. Join the effort. Visit unicefusa.org.
The Talk of Muskegon. News Talk 1090. WKBZ.
Well, your dadgum government, you sorry so-and-sos. You got your damn hands in every pocket of my clothes.
The dadgum government's got its buddies. In this case, we're talking with Jack Spencer from the Mackinac Center. We've got Tracy Lorenz, construction company owner. Oscar Oswald back here, and I am your dear, lovable, little, friendly, laid-back host, Jim Riley.
Right.
And, you know, this insider deal where the Democrat Party primarily, but with sadly too many Republicans in our state and certainly in our county here, just lay back and let the insiders or those, frankly, those people with the loudest voice win these arguments is maybe these days are about to change. And I'll before I get into Jack's, hopefully in the comments, it'll make us feel a little bit better. There's a another article that was, I believe, in the Michigan Capital Confidential, but it talked about the fact that fewer and fewer prevailing wage laws are being enforced. Matter of fact, they're being kicked out. But in fact, the total cost in the state of Michigan is around $200 million of extra money to the taxpayers of the state of Michigan. So we got any light at the end of the tunnel, Jack?
Well, as far as the state is concerned, the state laws, the ones that you have to do if you're using state money, there was talk last year, serious talk in the legislature about either modifying or getting rid of that. And as a matter of fact, there was a point last summer where it was almost looked like they were going to do it. And then we got into election season and it got eaten up by a whole bunch of other things, which isn't unusual. So I'm guessing that is a very real possibility for them to attack this year.
In other words, they would take the prevailing wage requirement on state-funded projects.
Right.
Okay. And you know, I would hope that the Republicans, and I know politicians want to get reelected, and I certainly, as someone who's run for office and lost, there's a lot of effort involved and money involved, and certainly you've got to look at your population. But I had somebody mention this to me. They said, well, you know, I'm going to be for this this concept, perhaps because that's what the people in my area, you know, support. Well, I went back and I looked at the vote for the freedom to work issue, and not only did it, well, of course, it was the union proposal, which or constitutional amendment that would have forced a union membership, and of course that failed in the state of Michigan, but it also overwhelmingly failed in Muskegon County, and in I just happened to pick one district. easily because it was the township. But in Muskegon County, which, to the best of my knowledge, has very rarely, if ever, elected a Republican. So Muskegon Township is considered to be a very strongly Democrat county. It's got 6 or 7 precincts. That forced unionization constitutional amendment failed in every single precinct. Mm. So the people, there certainly is very loud support from the union supporters for this insider deal where they get to bump up their pay and benefits on the back of the poor and the back of the employees and the employers of the county. But there really isn't, even in the most Democrat portions of our county, our very Democrat portions, there isn't grassroots support for this type of ripoff.
Well, it's very interesting, Jim. I did an article actually on this for another a newspaper I do some editorials for just a few weeks ago. When you get the right messaging, when you can get your message out, it shows where the voters really are on these things. In that article, I pointed out that they seem to be, in general, more aware, or it seems to be easier to get them aware of some local situation where there's a city's in $20 million in deficit, et cetera, when it's close to home, they seem much more likely to get it.
Well,
and then vote it out. Then when it's $16 trillion at the national level, it becomes abstract.
Yeah, I agree with you, and I think that's what you certainly have done with your reporting on this, and hopefully we're going to get the word out. Tracy, you know, you're down in, like, so you live in Ottawa County, but you do business in the surrounding counties also, and you're seeing, well, you're seeing what's happening is that the inside politically well-connected companies are again using this rip-off tactic, and frankly squeezing out those companies that are really trying to do the growing and the hiring in our area.
And it's not like you have to get rid of union labor, because the unions can still they kick in money to the contractors to help out the union contractors, which is fine. Say, just to use some round numbers, say a union electrician is going to bid a job at $100,000, but it's not prevailing wage, so they know they don't have much of a chance. The union can go to the contractor and say, "Well, we'll pick up $20,000 of that." So then the contractor bids it at $80,000. If he gets the job, he gets $80,000 from the job and $20,000 from the union to keep his guys working. So it's not like you're going to eliminate unions by doing this. It just makes a little more level playing field.
Well, that's an interesting point, that they can go out there. In other words, the unions have the flexibility because they've got this big slush fund.
Right.
But it's the little guys like yourself and the smaller companies and the individuals that are out there trying to grow their own little businesses that really get squashed on this even more than the poor taxpayer.
Now, isn't that interesting, Jim? Isn't this the opposite argument that the liberals always use about Walmart? The big guy is
right.
Squeezing out the little guys.
Yeah.
And this is just absolutely inverted. It's totally inconsistent.
Well, it's totally inconsistent, in particular when you see the Democrat chairman of the Muskegon County Board of Commissioners walking through the front door of Walmart.
Yeah,
which
but
Walmart
that,
was
that's
it?
His money in his wallet.
Sherman,
yeah, not
Sherman
other people's
or,
money.
Yeah, the hypocrisy is pretty thick here. Okay, but you did say, Jack, you told us off air that there is a possibility that the state will get rid of the state requirement, but that then leaves us with the county, Muskegon County, one of the few counties, arm in arm, standing tall with Wayne County and Genesee County and probably a few other failed counties in our state with this self-imposition. Is there any way to stop the self-imposition?
Yeah, it'd have to be local voters. Obviously, they'd have to have their voices heard and say, "Hey, how come you're making it more expensive for me than it is in the rest of the state on these projects?"
Okay, so it's up to us, and we're going to have to rely on AM Live, who thankfully and I thought graciously did promote the fact that the Muskegon County Republican meeting tomorrow night at 6 o'clock at Muskegon Community College, room 1202, with your Mackinac Center Director of Labor Policy, Vincent. Is it Vernuccio?
Yes.
Okay. They at least publicize this. We've got to get the word out. We've got a county that's fixable. We've got a beautiful county. I will say to Tracy over here, who does live in Ottawa County, I think we've got a far prettier, far more lovely place to live in, but you can't get work here.
That's right.
And
there's
and
no place that can touch Muskegon County as far as natural resources or anything else, but it's just so repelling to anyone that wants to do anything here.
And sadly, it's all done on purpose. It's not by mistake. We didn't have bad luck.
Right. You know, I did see in the paper this morning the Brunswick building's coming down, another union landmark to be leveled.
Yeah, it is. It's, you know, Standard Brands, the Hostess Twinkie companies, or whatever the brand company was, they've been sold, and the union stood tall there, stood tall, firm, and loud, and lost all the jobs for those folks. Sadly, that has to do with the owners of the company and certainly the union workers and those who did not want to go on that suicidal strike. But here in the state of Michigan, and in particular in Muskegon County, we've got the ability to change it. We just keep continuing to roll down the hill with jails that they say there's plenty of money for, and there's not only plenty of money, but we can pay 10, 20, right, maybe 30% more just because we
can. And it's so easy to make the comparison, the apples-to-apples comparison, if they just go out in some sort of pre-bid or a budget bid, and everybody gives them out. I mean, you just sell it to three different or four different contractors.
Last I heard,
what's it gonna cost?
No one at Muskegon County Finance Department has died from overwork. And
well, you were saying though earlier is that the prisoners were doing work. Why can't the prisoners do work on the jail?
I know.
Well, that's the main.
You might
reason.
Not use quite a stick of concrete or as much rebar in some of the walls.
What was that, Jack?
That was the main reason we stopped using prisoners for a lot of things back in the 30s and the 20s. Remember, we did, and the big problem was, they were taking, according to the unions, they were taking money away from the unions.
Yeah, and there's an argument there to, you know, there's back and forth, and I certainly can understand that. But this situation about prevailing wage, it is, I guess, thankfully, but sadly, too, mostly unique to Muskegon County. We can fix it, folks. We've got to get on the phone. If you go to iOnMuskegon.com, there's one of the more recent posts says, call them, they work for you, and it's a list of every county commissioner with their home phone numbers. And what we'd like to do is you pick up the phone and call your county commissioner and say, look, let's get this cleared up first before we do any bidding on this jail. Jack, thank you so much. You are a hero in my mind, and I'm sure many others. We'll have you back again soon, I hope, and you have a great Sunday.
Well, thank you very much. I always like being on the show, and I appreciate being invited.
Thank you, buddy. Bye-bye.
Yep, thanks, bye.
Jack. We'll be back.
Love me sometime.
Here's the official News Talk 1090 WKBZ forecast. A winter weather advisory continues till 11 a.m. A light wintry mix of precipitation this morning will transition to a few snow showers this afternoon with a high of 32. Northwest winds 10 to 20. Scattered flurries and snow showers tonight, a low of 21. Northwest winds 20 to 30. Flurries and a few snow showers expected throughout the day tomorrow with a high of 26. And then a mix of sun and clouds on Tuesday at a high in the low 30s. News Talk 1090, the talk of Muskegon.
Cold steel, rough concrete, tough plastic, synthetics. Today's world is enough to make us lose our real sense of touch and feel hundreds of miles away from nature. Luckily, that's not the case. There are places all around where you can get in touch with nature, at the National Wildlife Refuges. Here you can experience the warm, inviting touch of nature at every turn. Feel the smooth, gentle bark of a white birch tree on your fingertips. Walk barefoot on the smooth, water-worn river stones. Feel the soft moss lining a towering wall of limestone. When you feel these things, you're feeling the world the way we found it. With over 500 refuges across America, you don't have to go far to make a special connection with nature.
Learn more at fws.gov/refuges. That's fws.gov/refuges.
The Exquisite Corpse. A very unusual and completely amazing story pieced together out of so many parts that it is not possible to describe them all here, so go ahead and just start reading. The full moon lights the silver rails winding around dark mountains and over steep gorges of jagged rock and one freezing cold rushing black mountain river. I wish there was enough time to describe all of the funny twists and turns, especially the elephant clown party, that led up to now. But there isn't enough time, because there is a ticking clock, and the two passengers we care most about don't know anything about it. In a sleeping berth in the third car from the end of the train are two children, 11-year-old twins who have just run away from the circus. The girl's name is Nancy, the boy's name is Joe. They have no idea that those are not their true names, though they will figure it out soon enough. To see what happens next, visit read.gov to read The Exquisite Corpse, a riveting adventure pieced together by John Cheska, Shannon Hale, Daniel Handler, and other popular authors. Explore new worlds. Read. This exciting message is brought to you by the Library of Congress and the Ad Council.
I knew I had a problem.
I tried counting calories, eating and eating.
Nobody else could possibly understand.
We understand. We're Overeaters Anonymous, and we have helped thousands of people stop their compulsive eating and start living a healthy, rewarding life.
With OA, I am living again and loving it.
Start living the life you deserve with help from Overeaters Anonymous. Find us on the web at OA.org.
If you even think you may be in danger of foreclosure, call the National Foundation for Credit Counseling today at 866-687-6322 or visit MortgageHelpNow.org. That's 866-687-6322 or visit MortgageHelpNow.org. This has been a public service from the NFCC.
24,000 children die every day from preventable causes. My name is Salma Hayek, and I believe that number should be zero. Believe in zero.
Join the effort. Visit unicefusa.org.
Well, your dadgum government, you saw it so-and-so's. You got your damn hands in there.
All righty, we are back at Ion Muskegon. This is Jim Riley with Tracy Lorenz, Oscar Osbo. And on the phone, we have the chairman, the relatively newly elected chairman of the Muskegon County Republican Party, Andy Fink. Good morning, Andy.
Morning, Jim.
And why did you call us?
Tracy, I don't know you, but I know of you.
There we go. you had something you wanted to say, Andy. Jump on.
I just wanted to point out that one of the problems we have with this right to work, or not with the prevailing wage, is Republicans who are afraid to take a position. I got an email from a staffer for one of our Republican elected officials saying that, gee, this was not the right time for us to raise prevailing wage. They might get in trouble in Lansing.
Well,
and I thought, well, what the heck?
Well, that's exactly it. And what I found interesting, because I was privy to this email, what I found interesting was it's critically important to bring it up right now for Muskegon County, because this $2 million to $5 million to maybe $10 or $15 million is going to be locked in shortly. So in other words, to avoid embarrassment by some elected Republicans, we're going to let the poor folks in Muskegon County take it up the wazoo, because we're going to be quiet because we don't want to embarrass anybody.
Well, yeah. Now, you got to remember that everybody has his own axe to grind, and politicians think the parties are there to get them elected, whereas people like you and I who work in the politics think that our goal is better government. And the elected officials are a tool for us, not the other way around.
You know, that's well stated. Better government is the ultimate goal, and more efficient and leaner and more accountable government. And when you've got folks who are theoretically on our side, theoretically the good guys, saying, ooh, this might be uncomfortable for me, even though your issue is coming up right now, within, you know, they could vote on this jail within the next couple of weeks if necessary.
I disagree with him, and I will not respond in the way that he would like me to, because I'm going to go ahead with this, of course.
Yes.
But I understand that everybody has his own perspective on things. My perspective is to improve government, and if Republican politicians don't like it, it saddens me.
Well, I agree with you 100%. Thank you for putting together this public information seminar tomorrow night. Again, 6 o'clock, Muskegon Community College. We're going to talk about prevailing wage, not just statewide, but we're going to really focus here on the state of Michigan, or on the county of Muskegon. So, Andy, thank you. Go to church. Drive carefully.
May I say one more thing?
Yes, sir.
we're doing prevailing wage tomorrow night, but I hope that every month, or almost every month, we will have a similar topic of discussion at our Republican meetings. People ought to take a look at the Republican Party in Muskegon County.
We've got this old geezer running it, but it's got youth flowing through the blood.
Thanks, Jim.
Okay, thank you, Andy. All righty. Oscar, we can take a break, or should we yak for a little bit?
Oh, we already took our break.
We already took our break. Hey, a couple things. We are trying truly to educate the folks here in Muskegon County and anybody listening. As I've said before, so many of the things that happen here in Muskegon County are happening in other counties, other cities throughout the country. And, you know, so many people have said, you know, that these bad things that various folks like myself and others, caution us about, they can't happen here. But, of course, we've had our school system, one of the few school systems in the United States of America that's gone bankrupt in the Muskegon Heights school system. And we have...
we're proud of our adequate ranking.
We are proud that Muskegon Heights Middle School for years had a big banner. You know, 2 years, adequate progress. Oorah, I think is what they had on there. And so tens of thousands of people in Muskegon County drove by that. And still nothing happened until it ultimately shut down.
Oorah would have been a more adequate word. So they said wow.
It wasn't oorah. It was oh yeah. But so these things can happen. You can ultimately get to the end. But unfortunately, we're somewhat like Detroit in the sense that while Detroit is going bankrupt many decades ago actually, but has just kept on life support with millions upon millions of dollars and obviously with employees that feel comfortable enough with the work situation to take a job in another county 70 miles away and make a combined almost $250,000 a year. We here in Muskegon County have we're not in Detroit-style bankruptcy or anything along those lines, but we do have 10 times the per capita bond debt that Ottawa County has. In other words, here in Muskegon County, just bond debt alone is 10 times what the bond debt is in Ottawa County. We have, I believe, maybe 10 times or certainly 5 to 10 times the amount of unfunded pension and health care debt for the county employees. In other words, we are getting credit cards at the county building. They're getting credit cards, and they're just filling them out and saying, hey, we got plenty of money here.
It's coming
to
mail.
And at some point, that credit card mentality is going to come home to roost. And one of the awful things is as the budget for the county, and this is, I'm talking just the county, but we're seeing other cities. The city of Muskegon didn't have enough money for their, what they believe, a very important senior transit. And there's any number of things where the excuse is we don't have the money. And yet, when they have the opportunity to get frivolous with it, really, really frivolous with it, like buying iPads for all the county commissioners and providing full 24/7 internet connections and things of that. Those are little things, but I think I mentioned this last week, but, you know, Mayor Giuliani, one of the first things he did when he became mayor of New York, he took over a disaster back in the 80s, and he went after the small things. He went after the graffiti. He went after the purse snatchers, the items that had essentially been decriminalized by the previous Democrat mayors of New York City. And, of course, Mayor Giuliani was excoriated. I mean, he was one of the meanest, most nasty guys in the world, stopping young artists. And truly, they were called young. Well, of course, they called them graffiti artists today. But and yet it was the little things that mattered. And we have here at our county commission. And sadly, in too many of our cities, not so much in the townships, but sadly in some of the cities, where it's the little things that really give you a sense of the mindset, where, oh, hey, it's only $10,000 here. We had, not long ago, all of you Volt owners in Muskegon County, you can tell there are many, many Volt owners in Muskegon County, who now have the ability, because Muskegon County government paid for it. We have plug-ins. I believe there are two of them. The overfilled, by the way, it's overfilled parking lot at the county building, and there are two very expensive plug-ins for electric cars, which, to the best of my knowledge, have never, ever been used. And this is the mindset, the Democrat who shops at Walmart while telling people how awful Walmart is.
Now, how do those plug-ins work? Anyway, do they have to pay for that, or what?
Well, you would think that, but no. There's, to the best of my knowledge, the ones that Muskegon County has put in, and I believe the city of Muskegon is the same thing. There's no method to charge anybody for it. So you get the free electricity if, in fact, you utilize it. But to the best of my knowledge, there's only one volt in the county. Mm-hmm. And it's by a relatively well-to-do gentleman. And although that car itself is massively subsidized by the taxpayer. But, hey, a couple things I want to make sure. Remember, we are back now at Carmen's. Took a little time off. Went skiing with Honey Bunch this past week. Every Tuesday and Thursday, when the county is in session, I'm at Carmen's at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. And I'm usually there from about 2 to 3:15. And then I stroll over with who's ever decided to stop in and say hi. And everybody is welcome. We can talk politics, county, state, city, whatever, from 2 o'clock to 3:15. And then I go over to the county building. I video the county commission meetings. And we put all those meetings up on IonMuskegon.com.
And they all love you over there.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, it's funny. It does take a little bit of courage, and I must say, to stand tall, because people don't like people who come in and say, hey, we've had this ripoff going on for years, and we don't want you, you know, to expose it. Yeah. We have Republicans, Professor Andy Fink has just so eloquently stated, that are not happy that we are talking about uncomfortable things to talk about. Hey, a couple of other things just about unions, since we were talking about this. Yeah, the Muskegon County Courthouse just finished a $3 million renovation. You can be sure that was under prevailing wage. And it's kind of stunning to me that our county administrator and our county finance director, neither one of them even knew that prevailing wage was a self-imposed, in particular the finance director. And we just finished spending $3 million. I wonder how much additional.
I didn't know that. Yeah. I thought it was a law or something. If you did state or county work, that it had to be.
Well, remember now, if it's state money or federal money, then that is the law. All right.
But I didn't know county was.
But if it's county money, doing your own, and I suspect this county courthouse renovation, $3 million has just been done.
So the schools that are under prevailing, it's optional.
That would be my understanding. That's a really good point. Suppose a school board goes out and builds a new school or whatever. Is prevailing wage
saying
a requirement?
Like the janitorial is put out for bid, and that's always prevailing wage. So you pay the janitors, you know, $60,000 a year, whatever it is.
The way I understand the law is simply this, that if it's federal money involved, prevailing wage is the law. If it is state money involved so far, and Jack Spencer said that might change, but if it's state money that funds the particular project, then prevailing wage is the law. If it's a millage that says we're going to build a new school or build something else, that's local money, and it might very well be a self-imposed additional fee for the well-connected insiders who are certainly in Muskegon County bleeding this county dry at so many different levels. And again, this, you know, I find it amazing that this Hobbs Act, which criminalizes extortion and robbery by using the threat of fear of force, which is a good law, and labor unions are by law excluded from this.
It's amazing.
Hence their actions when they were over in Lansing and cutting down the tent and all that kind of garbage. Needless to say, now let's be clear, most union folks are not that way. By far and away, the vast majority are not. And I don't blame anybody who's a member of a union or a public employee for taking advantage of what's available there. The people I do blame are the people that we have elected, we have compensated, and we have empowered to do the right thing, to bring us better government. In this case, it would be our 9 county commissioners, our 2 state representatives, and our state senator. And certainly if you live in a city or a township, those leaders. We don't just compensate them. And we don't just rely on them to do the right thing. We've given them the power. We don't have that power here. We can't do the right thing because we said, look, we expect you're going to give us better government. You're going to balance the books. You're going to do the homework that is necessary so that you can make those wise judgments. And when we find that we've got a county executive, executive who's been there for, good Lord, 4 years or longer, gets excellent remarks or excellent marks across the board, doesn't know that about prevailing wage. When you get a finance director who says, well, I never even looked at it.
Yeah, that's stunning.
Well, it is stunning. It reminds me of the example that I brought up earlier about this guy in Detroit who's got 2 jobs. He's one in Flint, one in Detroit. Nobody even knew.
Well, somebody went to the commissioners or whoever and said, you know, there's some people that want to rake your yard. This guy you got to pay $40 an hour. This guy you got to pay $5 an hour. They'd probably pay a little more attention.
I think I know who the county or how the county commissioners would act if it was their own money. Many of them have owned businesses. Certainly, and there's nothing wrong with acting in your own self-interest. But there is something morally wrong with spending other people's money with abandon, without even taking the time to find out how much it costs. I mean, you know, I could see that maybe a county commissioner might be willing to come into this studio and talk about, wait a minute, I want to explain to you why it makes more sense to spend $5 or $10 or $15 or $20 million on a jail. And they might have an argument. They might say, well, we've got better labor or who knows what. But at least, number one, know what it's going to cost. And number two, come here with a cogent argument. But in fact, they hide under the ignorance of what's going on in our county. People don't know this. The term prevailing wage is a term that, well, as we just found out, one of our elected representatives is uncomfortable that even Republicans at a Republican county meeting would even have a conversation about. That tells you the fear that elected officials have of the union folks. And in full view of the fact that when it came to a vote just a few months ago, when the union said, support us, we want to change the Constitution to require unionization, not only did it fail in Michigan overwhelmingly, not only did it fail in Muskegon County overwhelmingly, in arguably the most Democrat county or the most Democrat precinct in our county, Muskegon Township, it failed in every single precinct. So amazing. There ought to be some support. There ought to be some spine to coming from our elected leaders. Sadly, there is not.
Throw some water on him. He's getting a little hot.
Yeah. Well, you know what? I am hot because I love this place, and I'm sick and tired of folks who are grossly, in my view, certainly if not overcompensated, well compensated, who don't even know the basics. And I'm not talking about just about the county administrator Hammersley and the finance director. I'm talking about our county commissioners. They have a responsibility. We have given them that responsibility and the power. Okay, we're coming to the end of the day, folks. I will relax a little bit. But guess what? from noon to 1 o'clock every Sunday, the Renegade River Show with Mike Hewitt is on. And today I will be guest hosting. Mike's going to be calling in from Las Vegas where he's at some kind of whack job gun show. You know, all those crazy gun guys. And I'm going to go home, and I'm going to come back in just a little bit. So listen in at noon today. Hey, don't forget, the full audio of the show is on ionmuskegon.com. I post it Sunday afternoons. You can watch any of the shows at ionmuskegon.com.
And that's E-Y-E, right?
That's E-Y-E on Muskegon, all one word. Thank you for pushing that. All of my show prep, by the way, is on muskegonpundit.com, and I post on that blog. I've got over a quarter million hits on that. And MuskegonPundit.com, that's also one word. I'm also on the Talking Muskegon show every Monday, Wednesday, Friday from 8 to 9 in the morning with John Van Wyk and Brian Worsham. And Oscar's got us back on prime time. Thank you, Oscar. We got the video, so you can see me waving my arms and getting excoriated. Or
watching you turn red.
Watching me turn red. Every Monday night, 8 to 9:30 on Comcast Channel 397 or TV 38. And I am not Jim McCormick. Jim McCormick, even though if you look at the Comcast...
It still says Jim McCormick?
It still says Jim McCormick. So people looking for Jim must have thought he...
Poor guy.
Not that I look that young, but relative to Jim, who's sadly not with us, he's gone to Ponce de Leon's place down there in Florida. And let's see, what else we got going here? That's about it. I'm done. I got it all.
You got it all? Well, I can bring back up what I was trying to bring up earlier.
Go
for
it.
Was the if the county building has those two plugs that they can plug into and free electricity, why can't we have two gas pumps over there so we can pull up and fill up a gas in our
vehicles? What about the electric down at Pier Marquette?
Yeah.
Wouldn't you have to be there for like 8 hours to charge your car anyway? You'd be kind of sunburned by the time you got done.
Well, we don't want that to happen. No sunburn in this town. No. Hey, folks, thank you for listening in. Thanks, Tracy. Thanks, Oscar. And thanks to the Mackinac Center. Next week, we'll be back. And we'll put the eye on you, Muskegon.
A message from Orlando Bloom, Joel Madden, Nicole Richie, Neo, and Taya Leone.
24,000 children die every day from preventable causes.
Like not getting enough food or medicine.
Or clean, safe water to drink.
But we are gaining ground. A generation ago, twice as many children were dying.
Still, 24,000 every day?
I believe that number should be zero. Believe in zero.
Join the effort. Visit UNICEFUSA.org.
I see this ad on TV. I call. They told me to stop paying my bills, stop talking to my creditors. They'd take care of everything.
I gave them thousands, but most of it went to their fees.
Getting out of debt isn't easy. Talk to your creditors directly or visit debtadvice.org. Real solutions for real people. This has been a public service message.
The Talk of Muskegon is News Talk 1090, WKBZ Muskegon, and heard 24 hours a day on WOOD HD2 Muskegon.
KBZ Muskegon and WOOD HD2 Muskegon.
Good morning and welcome to